We're going to go ahead and get started. Thank you for coming. I know that many of you, I saw a lot of you working out, either whether you had practice today or you were just getting in shape for your spring season. So I'm glad that you were able to make it. There are a couple things that I want to say about tonight. One, we do need your full attention, so cell phones and anything else that's distracting should be put away. That includes, you know, whatever else, homework, whatever. So we're going to put that away. We do have someone here videotaping tonight, so just be aware of that. And that is for folks who have classes on Tuesdays and Thursdays and aren't able to attend. Are there any questions before we get started? Okay. We've asked Amanda Collins' band to come. She is the sexual respect
educator
at Amherst College, but she's done a lot of work around the state. She worked at UMass Amherst and has done a lot of work with Deval Patrick, our former governor. So she's here and has a wealth of knowledge, and I think has a really good program for us tonight that's going to be helpful and enlightening, and I'm going to go ahead and let her get started.
How are you doing?
Good.
Good. All right, excellent. Thank you, first of all, so much for having me here tonight on this cold and snowy evening. I appreciate you making the trek out. I was in my house, and I was like, oh, it's cold. but I'm super happy to be here. My name is Amanda. I do work at Amherst. And I've been doing work related to sexual violence prevention for the bulk of my career, which is like over 20 years. I've approached it from a lot of different angles. I've done work in sexuality education because healthy sexuality is really the foundation for how we can prevent a lot of sexual violence, is to teach children younger how to have healthy relationships where they have good, healthy, wanted, enjoyable sex if that's a behavior that they choose to engage in. And now I'm doing prevention work, mostly focused on sexual violence prevention, looking at a wide range of behaviors. So sexual violence exists on a continuum, right? We know that there's lots of behaviors. Some people refer to some of it as sexual misconduct. I like the term sexual violence because I think it calls it for what it is. And I think that people's reactions and how they experience things that might be referred to as like milder actually can be pretty hard to experience, particularly based on our identities, right? So if we've had a lot of history of sexual violence in our lives, somebody yelling something out a window at us might have a profound effect on our emotional well-being in that moment or for a period of time. Whereas other people who maybe haven't had that same history may not have that reaction. There's no right or wrong way to respond to any type of sexual violence. Tonight, as you all are aware, the NCAA has asked for every athletic team across the country to participate in a yearly program on some topic related to sexual violence prevention. And different schools are approaching that in different ways. In my conversations this summer, what we really wanted to do was to think about this as kind of an introduction to a conversation that, depending on what year you are, you're going to have over the next 2, 3, 4 years. And my hope is that in whatever way feels comfortable and safe for you, you're able to engage around this conversation in different ways and to approach it in different ways. It's an extraordinary time, I think, in our country where people are actually starting to look at sexual violence. And in looking at sexual violence, we also need to look at other types of oppression. Because if you're going to eliminate sexual violence, it means you need to eliminate all types of oppression, because they're so deeply interconnected. And I feel hopeful. I actually do. I think it's a painful time, but I also feel hopeful that this is a time of culture change. And so I'm really excited to be here to spend this time with you. I have about an hour with you, which is a really short time, and I have so much that I want to say. And then I'm going to turn it over to your Title IX coordinator, who's going to give you some information about Montpelier-specific resources. I do want to put out, too, that this topic can be really difficult for people, right? And so I would encourage you to practice self-care, whatever that looks like for you. If you need to step out of the room for a little bit, if you need to do follow-up or ask a question of me later or one of the staff people that you have in the room, I would encourage you to do that. Talk to each other, support each other, And I hope that you can stay as present as possible in the short time that we have together. So I always like to share with people, I sometimes get asked, first of all, sexual respect educator is like the best title ever, because when you say it, like at a cocktail party, I never go to cocktail parties, I don't know why that's my example, but if I say it at a party, people are always like, oh my god, she just said sex, ah! And I also find that really interesting, because literally, that's sometimes what people do. And I always think that that's really fun, because it provides me an opportunity to be like, sexual respect is about more than sex, it actually has very little to do with it, so, all right. Here we go. All right, so this is why I started, well, it's not why I started, because I hadn't even thought I was going to have kids when I started doing the work, but it's one of the reasons I continue to do the work. These are my two kids, and I am really hopeful that we all together are going to be able to create a world in which all kids feel safe and free from sexual violence. So, okay, does anyone have any questions? All right, so I wanted to spend a little bit of time talking about rape culture. Have people heard that term before? I hope so, yeah. when I say that term, what do you all think? What comes to mind when you think that? Is it because we're being recorded?
No.
I don't know if this is still a current statistic, but I know that, or I've heard in the past, that 1 in 4 women are victims of sexual assault. And so that's 6.
Yep, so that's, so you'll hear somewhere between 1 in 3 and 1 in 5 cis women experience sexual violence. The numbers are significantly higher when we talk about transgender folks or gender nonconforming. So, and the numbers aren't, the statistics are not great, but you'll hear anywhere from 1 in 12 to 1 in 15 for cis men. And the numbers also vary greatly depending on your racial identity as well. So for instance, Native American women, African American women, experience significantly higher rates of sexual violence than, for instance, white women. So yeah, so this clear prevalence of sexual assault and rape. Anything else? But when we allow things like victim blaming or that boys will be boys, kind of that idea of like what a man should be, what a woman should be, because we of course are only recognizing the gender binary when we're talking about rape culture, are things that people are somewhat dismissive of, or they're so common that we sometimes don't notice them. They provide that foundation for the things at the top to happen. So when we're not confronting things at the bottom, it creates a culture in which sexual violence is, first of all, pervasive, which is the culture in the US right now. And it's also not challenged particularly often. That's changing, right? And we all know that people have been challenging that for a long time, but it's now that some people are starting to pay a little bit more attention to that naming or calling out of the behavior. I think it's important when we talk about this kind of culture that exists on our campuses. I know Amherst has a problem with a lot of behaviors on this pyramid, is that we want to recognize that we need to be thinking and talking about kind of this whole spectrum of behavior if we have a hope of ending the things at the top. So most people would say that things at the very top are bad, right? Most people would say that shouldn't happen, in theory. I say most because it's not all. And then there's a lot more people, though, as you go further down the pyramid that think, like, that's okay, I don't know why I'm getting so upset. Or if you've ever tried to confront somebody who's telling perhaps a joke that makes rape seem okay, people might be dismissive of it. Oh, you're just being sensitive. Oh, you should just let that go. It's not that big of a deal. But it actually is, because it creates this culture where we are less likely to believe, recognize, and support survivors of sexual violence at all levels. Okay. Does anyone have any questions about this? All right. And so the other point that I want to make is at the bottom, if we are making jokes or comments or tolerating behaviors that target specific people, and make it as a culture that certain people have less value or less worth in our culture, then we're actually saying that treating them as less than is okay, which allows sexual violence to be more permissible for people. It's why when you look at some of the movements that are happening now, the voices that are getting the most attention are who? Like, who do you see most often being front and center in the mainstream media? Survivor. It's generally attractive, white, attractive by like our media cultural norms, right? White, cis, straight women who are, I don't know, actresses or whatever, right? So even when you look at how Me Too started to come into the forefront of media attention, it was started by a woman of color, Shauna Byrd, but the person who was credited for a period of time was Alyssa
Milano?
Yes, Rose McGowan. One of those people. From Charmed. They were all on that show, Charmed. 80s. Okay. 90s? 2000s? One of those shows? Okay. All right. So do people have questions about this? Have people seen this pyramid before? No. Does it help to put a little bit in context, maybe? All right. So what I'd like you to do is to pair off with somebody who's next to you. If you're in like a little group of three, you can do that too. Pair off a little bit. Pairs are better. I like pairs better. Because we're doing a pair and share, so really pairs are better. Like P-A-I-R, not P-E-A-R. Okay, I was just wondering who's next. Okay, all right. So I want you to think about this cultural pyramid. And if you could, if your partner, your dyad, or your triad, if you could share what is one thing that you think you as an individual person could do to challenge this culture. And then I'm just going to ask for a couple of people to share. You can ask your friend for suggestions if you're less shy.
What do you can do to challenge the culture as individuals?
Awareness and decrease stigma.
Yep, absolutely. How might you do that?
You have to start talking about it. It's scary, but you have to be willing to open up about it. And when you start opening up about it, people start to listen and people start, can like more easily identify.
Anyone else? Yeah?
When you are the victim, to not apologize for it.
Not apologize. So for those of you who think there's a couple that I always think of, of course that's such a good one, is to watch the type of media that you consume. Right? Which is, we sometimes don't think about the power of our voice in ways of like how we can lead with our money. Right? So like the magazines that you buy, canceling subscriptions when there's like inappropriate or problematic content, right? The shows that you choose to engage in. I think those are ways that you can send a message kind of en masse to say to someone like, this actually isn't okay. And it can be even more powerful if you explain to people why it's not okay. You know, I look at our Women's and Gender Center has subscriptions to a number of magazines, and so this year they started subscribing to Teen Vogue, which has been doing some really great work around sexual violence prevention, as well as like sexuality in general. So also using your money to support publications that you feel like are doing some work that is moving us forward rather than setting us back. You know, it can be when you think about the presents that you choose to buy for kids in your life. You know, do you buy always the gender typical present for that gender, or do you try to buy things that maybe challenge the possibilities that exist for who they can be? So there are small ways that you can do that. You know, when you, my nephew, when he was younger, fell and cried, and some of the men were like, boys don't cry, and I was like, boys absolutely cry, you can cry anytime you want to. Auntie Amanda says, cry away! They do not see me as political at all. And so I think that those are also messages that you can reinforce with kids in your life about what is it to be a boy, what is it to be a girl, what is it to challenge that gender binary and be who they want to be and explore who they want to be. So those are ways that you can kind of really, that don't, maybe they don't seem that big, but they're ways that you can change the culture really subtly or overtly, depending on how loud you raise your voice. I tend to raise mine. So any questions about that? So my challenge for you, for folks that couldn't think of it, is to really over the next couple of days think about what are things that you can do, and recognize that there's safety considerations for folks, but like what are some things that you can do that feel comfortable, that allow you to kind of dip your toe into the water and thinking about how can I change culture? Because this is really where the movement needs to be, is when we think about the culture that we're creating in our communities. Okay, all right. I wanted to talk a little bit about consent. Are people familiar with Sexual Assault Awareness Month? Do you do events here? So there's a national organization, the National Sexual Violence Resource Center, that sponsors something, and it's out of the Pennsylvania Coalition Against Rape, sponsors Sexual Assault Awareness Month, and they have different kind of like themes every year. Last year it was Change the Culture. This year, it's about raise your voice. So using your voice for positive change. And one of the things that we're talking about is this concept of everyday consent. Have people heard about this? How would you describe it? Everyday consent is this idea that as we walk through the world, there are times where we should be asking if something is okay, right? So if you're somebody who, when you first meet people, you give people a hug, right? Do you ask if it's okay first? Or do you just kind of like go in for the hug, right? Are there ways that when we are engaging with people, we're asking if it's okay to touch them or to move by them or to be like in a space, say for instance. And it's a little bit hard to wrap our head around, because whenever I talk about consent at different college campuses, people talk about how it's awkward, it doesn't seem natural, is this really how people are communicating? First of all, I don't think a lot of us have grown up with really good models about how people are communicating about a range of behaviors, sexual behaviors, and I consider like hand-holding to
sex, however you define sex, which is really complicated to me, as a range of behaviors around that. That we don't have really good models for how people do it. A lot of times people are doing behaviors in private, or you're not privy to conversations that they're having. But the idea of everyday consent is that, let's say that you have a child in your life who likes to be tickled, right? And so you tickle, and then they say, no, stop, because like sometimes you live like too much when you get tickled, you know? And then do people stop, or do they keep going? A lot of people keep going, right? And so what is that message that's sending to that child about the control that they have within their body? So an example of everyday consent would be you stop, and then you ask, like, is it okay? Do you want me to tickle you? And then if it's one of my kids, they'd be like, yes, tickle me! And then I can tickle them, right? Because I've asked, and I've given them agency over their body, which I think is really important. And so that's kind of the concept of everyday consent, that it's not about sexual behaviors. It's really about when we're interacting with other people, are we respecting the agency that they should have over their bodies? Okay, so I'm gonna ask you to participate again. Are you gonna make me stand up here in silence? Because it'll hurt my feelings. Not really, but I'll feel kind of bad. Okay, they're talking. Okay. All right. So can people see if I write over here with the screen?
Okay. All right. So I want you to brainstorm with me what you think the elements of consent are. So you need to shout stuff out really loud so they can pick it up on camera.
Asking. Consent is important. An obvious affirmation.
Are there two F's?
Yes.
I usually just write messy, but I feel like I really shouldn't when I'm doing something like this. I'm an awful speller.
It can change. Your consent can change.
Checking in. Say what you want. Okay, so this is what we have. Mutual is another thing, so all of the parties, the people, the two people, three people, all the people that are there agree to what is happening, right? So they understand and agree. And I think that that's something that sometimes is also a way to challenge rape culture, is to challenge gender norms. This idea that some of us have learned that men ask for consent and women are gatekeepers, right? Which is a super unfortunate way to frame consent, because it implies, first of all, that men always are interested in sex, and so therefore we never say no. It also implies that women are somehow the gatekeepers for what should happen, and it also is the gender binary thing, which I really hate. So there's lots of reasons why the mutual piece is really important. Like, everyone needs to be okay, and so it's the responsibility of everyone in that situation to make sure they're checking in and asking and all this stuff is happening. It's revocable, we have that, it can be withdrawn at any point. And voluntary. And when we talk about voluntary, one of the things that I think is really important is that it can't be obtained through manipulation, when one person has power over another, or by threatening someone. And so what we might see in a college campus that would look like that is a professor that had control over somebody's grade, right? Or recommendation letters for a fellowship or an internship. A captain that had control over somebody's playing time, right? So that's where power, that you have to be careful. Voluntary is important. And we like to say an outward demonstration. So I think it's really important. We talked about informed, obvious affirmation. Obvious affirmation means to me that you're using language that both people understand, right? The less well you know somebody, the more drugs and alcohol might be present, the less clear body language is to interpret, right? And so if I have known somebody for a really long time, I've been with that person for a year or 2 years or 3 years, I may understand their body language. If I have not, I might not. I might misinterpret that, or I might deliberately pretend that I don't understand it. And so it's really important that you use mutually understanding. So we talked a little bit about ways that somebody might not have consent, but can you think of some other ways that consent can be given in a situation? So we had alcohol and drugs. And again, I think this is where somebody could have a glass of wine and be perfectly sober and able to understand what's happening. But other people might have one drink because of the medication they're on, or body weight, or hormonal differences, might have one drink and really not know what's going on. So I think that is really important to be aware of. It's not about an amount, it's about how it impacts the person. Any other ways? Things that people can think of that might compare that? Yes, conscious. I don't know if that's how you spell it, but when I was younger, I was an awful speller, and my dad, when he would like read my papers over, would circle the words and make me look them up in the dictionary, but I had spelled them so badly, I actually couldn't find them in the dictionary to be able to correct it. It was a very frustrating experience. Conscious. Sometimes people say passed out. If passed out is unconscious, right? So you should be conscious. What else might impact someone's ability?
Fear,
absolutely. And, you know, I think that it's important to understand what fear is like. So sometimes we might talk about fear as someone has a weapon. That certainly is fear, right? But there's also fear of somebody spreading a rumor. Or releasing videos or pictures that were taken, maybe consensually, but you didn't consent to have them released. And so there's lots of ways that fear can play into manipulating someone or forcing someone to give consent. What? So age is something that sometimes we don't think about on college campuses, but in the state of Massachusetts, the age of consent is 16. So folks under the age of 16 can't give consent. Even if they say yes, they can't legally give consent. Although most campuses don't have folks who are under 16, some do. We also have siblings that come to visit or family that come to visit, people who are here on recruitment weekends or touring the campus or other various, my kids come to camp here. And so those are all ways in which age might be a factor as well. And then power is another one that I would put up here, which I think is directly related to the fear. It can be, it cannot be, but there's usually a correlation. Any questions about this? Does it make sense? So I was thinking about culture and how culture, wait, now I have to, I had videos that, oh, now, oh gosh. This could be that, folks. That made me a little nervous. About how things sometimes change, that culture can change. So I grew up, with like Sleeping Beauty, which is super not consensual. So I'll tell you a story about why I have faith that things could change. So my youngest daughter, who's, she's something, she was at daycare. She was three and she was at daycare. And the teacher came up to me afterwards one day and said, "Amanda, I need to talk to you." And I was like, "Oh God, what'd she do?" And I said, "Uh-huh." And she said, "Race needs to stop kissing people." And I was like, "Oh my God, she didn't get consent, she didn't ask, I told her that she has to do this, I'm like, my life's work." So we're in the car and I said, "Gracie, Miss Caroline and Mr. Keith told me that you're kissing people and you're not allowed to do that without asking first. That's not okay." I did ask, and they all said yes. And I was like, okay. So I march into Miss Caroline, and I'm like, "Well, I just want to be clear that Gracie got consent for each and every one of those." She was like, "Yeah, it's flu season." I was like, "Oh, okay." Nice to meet you. And I laughed. They really enjoyed having you at that preschool. And so I was thinking about how different the world can be and how things can change. And so I took my kids to see Frozen a couple of years ago.
Do you like it?
Like it? I love it! I could kiss you. I could. I mean, I'd like to. May we? Wait, what?
We may.
Our media and our culture can change and can provide some positive messages, and I think that that's when I talk about what media you consume, it can make a difference, right? So consent is not implied or assumed. The absence of a no, coerced, it's not good forever, and you can't be given dr. high. I sometimes am asked by students like where the line is or how you know if somebody is too drunk to give consent or not. And this is what I tell people. I think that if you're asking yourself the question, then the answer is probably they are too drunk, right? Because even if they're not technically, if you're thinking, "I'm not sure if this person is sober enough," it means that they're not sober. And I think that that is an important reminder for all of us. I'm going to talk a little bit about bystander intervention at the end of the end of the presentation. And bystander intervention is basically when we see things that make us feel like that's not okay, or there's something that doesn't seem right about what's going on there. We take steps to try to intervene or stop it from happening. And what sometimes happens is people will say, "Well, I mean, I think they're drunk, but I'm not really sure. They look like they're having fun, and I'm not sure if they actually want me to interrupt it." And I would challenge you with the same thing. If you're thinking that they're too drunk, or if you're asking yourself the question, then the answer is yes, you should step in.
when we talk about, we talk a lot on college campuses about building community. You all have communities in the athletic department, within your teams, maybe in your residence halls, in academic classes or majors that you're a part of. And we also have a larger community. And I think that part of this is thinking about what kind of communities we want to create and what kind of care we want to take for each other, right? And those can be hard because it's not always easy. And sometimes we're wrong when we intervene. I've been there. But I'm not sorry that I did. And I think that's good. Okay, so there's lots of ways to say yes. I think when we think about what kind of words or actions, sometimes people are like, well, that's too formal, or it's too technical, or I don't want to use those words. And I think that there's lots of ways that we can communicate about what we like and what we don't want. That is not technical or textbook or anatomy lesson language. And so these are some. I had my, and I think too, when we talk about words, there's different ways of interpreting. I did this activity with my students where I had them come up with ways to say yes and ways to say no. And so they both had this one particular word on both sheets. And I was like, huh, you have the same word on both sheets. What's that about? And they're like, well, there's whoa, and then there's whoa. And I was like, oh, yes, that makes perfect sense. Could you tell which was the yes and which was the no? Right? And so sometimes it's also about the interpretation. But again, using words and actions that people understand. So, you know, let's go further. Yes, yes, yes. I'm not going to read these because that feels awkward. But there's a lot of them that you can see up there. No is also like, let's do something else. I'm not into this. I want to talk about this. I need some space. Let's be friends. Those are all no's. So. All right, so when we think about sexual violence, I'm gonna highlight a couple of different ones, but I think, again, it's really important to understand the spectrum that sexual violence exists on. Some of it is within our communities, and some of it is our folks outside our community bringing it in. We have a problem at Amherst. There's, if any of you have taken classes, there's Route 9 cuts through our campus. And our students experience significant amounts of street harassment on that road. Students, faculty, and staff, actually. Much of it is racialized street harassment. So specifically targeting people's racial or perceived racial identity and then making a sexual harassment around that. And so we have a big problem with that. I don't know if you have problems on 116 with that type of behavior. Yeah. I live in South Hadley, so I'm like, please say no. But it wouldn't surprise me if you did. So those are things, like that can be an example of when you're outside your community, y'all go to Amherst, if you go to Smith, if you're kind of over in the Commons area, and then when you're on your campus. But there's a lot of different types. You know, and I think our definition is ever expanding too, right? So when I was growing up, we didn't have cell phones or computers or any of that. And so the digital or cyber stalking kind of pieces that can happen now just weren't an option for people. Now you have sexual violence that can be people sharing pictures of folks, like so even if there's consensual pictures that are taken when the relationship ends, people releasing them or sharing them with other folks, non-consensual. Have street harassment, sexual assault and rape, relationship violence. We're going to focus today, stalking is also on the increase at a lot of college campuses across the country. We're not going to spend a lot of time talking about stalking at all, actually, but I'll say this. Stalking, sometimes the way that it's portrayed in the media is that there's a stranger who fixates on someone and then starts stalking them. The stalking that we most often see when I talk to my colleagues at other institutions is a relationship ends, one person doesn't want it to end, and then they engage in stalking behavior to try to keep track of their former partner, where they are, what they're doing, who they're seeing, who they're spending time with. And that is stalking that's sometimes not identified. And one of the things that happens on our campus, because we're so small, we have one dining common like you all do, we're a small campus, is that folks will see people, and then they're saying, are they following me, or is it just because there's only one dining commons? And so sometimes it can be hard for folks to identify it. If you leave here with one thing, it would be that if something feels uncomfortable or something doesn't feel right to you, it probably is not right. And that we're often socialized to kind of tamp down those instincts, which is super unfortunate, because our instincts can tell us a lot about our environment. And paying attention to what your body is trying to tell you or what your subconscious is trying to tell you about your safety, I think, is really important. You have folks on campus that you can talk to. You also have resources in the community that you can utilize. We are really well-resourced in the Pioneer Valley compared to other places. And I think that is something that I'm really happy about when I know that students, if they don't want to come and talk to somebody on our campus, have options on campus to kind of explore and really be here. And I would encourage you to think about those.
Okay. Does anyone have any questions about Spectrum?
Okay.
So dating and relationship violence. When you look at these two charts, what do you see? There, yep.
Can we full screen it?
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. Absolutely. That would actually be helpful, wouldn't it?
Okay. Play from current slide.
This is a new computer. I've had a Dell like forever, and now I'm like, I don't actually know how to work this. Okay. So what do you notice about these? That's much better. It's a little bit bigger.
What do you notice about these two lists?
They're exactly the same.
Why do you think they're the same?
Yeah. You might feel a little bit jealous about somebody spending time. You're not like super secure in the relationship and you're like, why are they spending time with that person? You feel a little jealous or a little possessive. That can be healthy and natural. It's when the jealousy and possessiveness come to a different level where you're starting to control somebody or make somebody feel bad about spending time with someone else or some other people, that it gets to be in that level of unhealthy behaviors, right? Wanting to be with a person all the time. When I first started dating my partner, I was like, 24/7, I want to be with you. Not really, because I wanted to be with my friends too, but I also really liked spending time with that person. Like, it made me happy. And so, but wanting to be with a person all the time to the exclusion of every other relationship that you have, or not wanting that person to spend time with other people, again, is where it gets to the next level. So, one of the ways that if you saw this happening, what could you do if you saw this happening? And you weren't sure, you're like, well, this could be totally fine, or it could be a symptom that something isn't super healthy. What could you do?
Check in.
You could check in, absolutely. You could be like, hey, I noticed that you're not really spending time with any of your friends, and we totally want to see you. Is everything okay? Oh yeah, it's just a new relationship. You can probably like feel it out a little bit and see if there's another conversation that you want to have. Maybe make a date to say like, let's all go to Val. Val, not Val. What's your dining column, Miss Val? Super Korean. Blanche. Oh, okay. I was like, what did you just say? Okay. Who several years ago was in a violent relationship with a male lacrosse player, also at UVA.
who ultimately killed her. And members of both teams knew that there was stuff that they were concerned about in the relationship. And her family has started the One Love Foundation in her memory. And they've actually been doing some really amazing work around raising people's awareness of relationship violence, what it looks like on college campuses, which is very different than how it often looks outside of college campuses with people who maybe are married or older or have been in relationships for a long time. And so they've done a couple of PSAs, and I'm going to say this one for you. Again, I would encourage you all to practice self-care. So I know that some of this can be hard to see.
Because I love you. I want to be your only guy.
Because I love you, skip class with me. Let's stay in bed today.
Because I love you, I just want to be with you so freaking much.
Because I love you.
I waited for you after Ken Lab.
You were walking with Mark?
Because I love you.
You shouldn't be hanging out with that dude.
You should know how dumb that makes me look.
I don't care if she's your lab partner.
Why do you have texts from him?
Because I love you. This number?
Delete.
Because I love you. This Jason number?
Delete.
And Ben?
Delete.
Because I love you, I should smash your phone.
I'll let you give me your password instead.
Because I love you.
I will check your texts every day.
You got lucky. Because I love you.
Because I love you.
You think it's okay?
Because I love you. You understand.
Because I love you, you stop talking to your classmates. And you feel completely alone.
Because I love you.
Emotionally abusive, so demeaning or degrading language, putting somebody down, making them feel bad about who they are. Social isolation is a big part of it, so cutting people off from friends and family. And so what struck me about this is the framing of it is because I love you. And that's how that often is. It's because I love you that I'm doing this, because I want to protect you, or I want you to be a better person, or I want to make sure that you succeed at your institution. Like, this is why I'm doing this, because I love you. And it's really about manipulation of love. But when we think about the question that's often asked of people is, why did it stay? It's because you do love that person. You love that person that you fell in love with. And you keep hoping that that's the person who's going to come back. And I think that that can be hard for people to kind of reconcile. But love and the manipulation of it is deeply embedded in relationship violence, which is what makes it hard for people to talk about, particularly if they feel like they don't have social support. And so leaving that social support open with somebody that you're worried about is in a relationship that's unhealthy is really, really important. Because when they reach a point where they feel like, I can't do this anymore, knowing that you are there for them and that you're always going to be there for them is going to be a really I'm gonna put this back in full screen.
So relationship violence, again, is about this power and control, right? So one person wants to have power and control over another. And there's different ways that that shows up in the relationship. So it can be isolation. It can be harassment, intimidation, limiting independence, using privilege, right? So we all carry some degree of privilege with us, if for no other reason than we're in college and getting an education. Using that privilege to control, demean, or degrade another person, or to exert that privilege and influence that you have over someone. So I had a friend who was in an abusive relationship with somebody who was very connected in the town that we lived in at the time. And so that was this area of privilege where my friend felt like, I can't access any of these resources in the town because this person has so much power in this area. And so it can look that way, or it can look like privilege because of racial identity or for gender identity. And when we think about privilege, it also, our identities can impact the type of help that we can get or that we feel like we can access, right? So for some folks, they may feel like they don't want to involve law enforcement because they feel that based on their racial or ethnic identity, they're not going to be treated fairly, or that their partner's lives are going to be in danger if they were to go to the police about a bad relationship or call 911, right? And so when we think about how and what services people are able to access or feel comfortable accessing, part of that is related to our identity. Humiliation is one, violation of personal boundaries. Again, it could be physical, emotional, verbal, spiritual, or digital or cyber is another way you can see it. And unhealthy relationships versus abusive relationships. Unhealthy relationships are where we really want to intervene with people that we care about, right, before it becomes abusive. Does anyone have questions about this?
All right, I have 5 minutes left. Okay, so warning signs of an unhealthy relationship. I was looking at the slide today, and I'm like, why did I agree that you're your friend and your partner's friend, your friend's partner? And I think I did it because I wanted to start the conversation of, like, you have this friend that you're worried about. And I did this activity at an event that we had a couple weeks ago where we had this Plinko board, and people had to do an intervention based on, were they friends with the perpetrator, were they friends with the bystander, were they friends with the person who was targeted by a particular behavior. And a lot of people did it, and almost to a person, everyone who got your friends with the perpetrator was like, I would not be friends with that person. Like, they were like, they absolutely did not want to participate in the game. They're like, this chocolate bar that you have does not make me want to participate in this game. And I was like, it's a really good chocolate bar, and you have to play the game. And part of the reason that we do that is I think that we often don't want to see people that we care about or that we respect as being people who can engage in behavior that is unhealthy or abusive or targets another person. But the reality is we all have people in our lives who do this. And it's pervasive. And it might not be that somebody is violent in a relationship. Maybe it's that they've catcalled someone. But the impact of that behavior is hard on the person who's targeted. And we owe it to our friends, if we think that they're engaged in problematic behavior, to talk to them. And so when we talk about intervention, a lot of times people think, like, I'm gonna say something and I'm gonna reach out to my person that I think is being targeted. But we also need to reach out to the person that we think might be perpetrating unhealthy behavior and talk to them about how they can get help. There are programs that can help people, how they can get help, how we can support them as they go through counseling or think about healthy relationships, because that is something that's gonna be preventative. Okay, so these are just some warning signs of unhealthy or violent relationships that you can see in a victim or a perpetrator. And what I would say is that often when we look at violent relationships or unhealthy relationships, the behavior that we see in public is not as severe as the behavior that is happening behind closed doors. And so I would encourage you, if you see behavior that's concerning to you that's happening in public, and you're kind of like, I'm not sure, if that's what's happening in public, you really do want to talk to people because there's probably worse things that are happening in those stories. Okay.
again, it's like that little instinct that you have in the back of your head that tells you that something's not okay. So sexual assault and rape are two terms that people use a lot. And I think that sometimes we don't actually know what they mean. I've been training people, and I just did a training with my peer advocates, which is my peer education group. And I put up the definition of sexual assault, which is any sexual contact that lacks consent or capacity to give consent. And that can include kissing or touching intimate parts of another person. And there was this like silence in the room that was like, felt different to me this year. And I had a couple of students, we went bowling afterwards. We did a group bowling bonding event. And a couple of the students said, you know, I had not thought about all these things that had become so normalized that I never thought of them in this way. Because they happened so often to me at clubs or at parties or at various locations where people would grab my butt or grab my breast or kiss me without asking, that I hadn't thought about what that actually was, what that behavior was. And again, I think that's going back to when we think about rape culture, it's because this behavior can happen so pervasively that we sometimes don't name it as a serious behavior that it is, even though it feels awful, right? And rape is having sexual intercourse without consent, which can include vaginal or anal penetration of the body part, not just general contact, forcing them to penetrate another person. And so I use here vaginal or anal penetration. Regardless of what people choose to call the parts of their body, the behavior doesn't change, right? So just to clarify that those are just the words that are part of the definition of our state and most honor codes, but it doesn't matter what you call it, it's the behavior. Does that make sense? Okay. And so I'm going to wrap up in my last 3 minutes with how to support a survivor. So I use the survivor really broadly. I think that there are untold numbers of us who have experienced some form of sexual violence, and that is really hard to sit with. And people feel comfortable sharing that information with people at different times. Sometimes there can be a trigger where people feel like, I really have to share this story right now. It can be something that happened years ago or decades ago or yesterday. It can be something that you feel like, gosh, if that happened to me, I might not have that strong of a reaction. Or it could be something that you would have the same reaction. None of those things really matter. What matters is how we approach and are there for the person who's disclosing to us. What I think is interesting is sometimes we think about people disclosing instances of sexual violence to people that they really care about in their lives, right? To like a friend or a partner. But sometimes that's not who people choose to disclose to. Sometimes it's people that they've met, that they've had, they're working on a group project with, that they're not especially close to, but they feel like maybe this person will get it because of something that they said. And so don't be surprised if over your life somebody discloses to you that you're not close to. It means that they got a vibe from you that felt like you might be a safe person for them to talk to. And the same is true that if you have a friend that hasn't disclosed to you, and you find out later, and you're like, I wish they had told me, that the stakes are really high when you tell somebody. The reaction that somebody gives to you when you share that information goes a long way towards helping somebody heal or causing them to kind of retreat a little bit more and not tell someone. So there's lots of reasons why people tell or don't tell. So I have four really simple things for you to keep in mind. Okay. The first is to listen, which sounds kind of self-explanatory, but that means you're not looking at your phone, you're not watching television, you're actually in the moment, present, and listening to this person that's sharing a story with you, and being there without judgment. So you may want to yell about this person who perpetrated violence. You may want to ask questions about why did you do this or this. You don't do any of that. You listen, right? You listen with your full attention, them and you're present in the moment. And then you validate their experience, right? We used to, 10 years ago when I did this, we used to say, believe the survivor. And for some people, they are not capable of that. So I'm going to give the advice that you validate their experience, okay? I choose to believe survivors when they disclose to me, but I think validating is really important. Remember that people have different reactions to violence. As I said before, it doesn't mean that one is right or wrong. It doesn't mean one is better or worse. It just means that it's different and it's individual to each of us. It's like, if anyone's had a breakup with somebody that they dated, we could probably poll and 10 different people would have 10 different reactions to a breakup. I'm not equating a breakup with sexual violence, but we all have our own innate way of dealing with things that happen to us. In any experience, if the same experience happened to 10 people in this room, we're going to have different reactions. They might be similar, they might not be. They're going to be different. And that's okay. There's no right way to respond to this. And again, people's history, how it felt targeted in their identity and their identities is also really important. Ask them what support looks like for them. So don't assume that somebody needs to go see a counseling center, or they need to talk to their parents, or they need to talk to a sibling. Put all that aside and say, what do you need from me? How can I help you? Because people are going to have different answers than someone else, right? Be patient. So there's no timetable to recover. So somebody might be having a hard time and you're going to push them like, you should come out with us. You should go out with us. You'll feel better. They might not, and that is okay. No, it's not about what you think that they should do or how you think they should feel, but how they're feeling. That doesn't mean if you see signs that you're super concerned about, like around self-harm, that you don't seek help. But within the context of somebody not harming themselves, there's a range of behaviors that are okay. All right. Okay, so bystander intervention, just super quick. Oh, I don't know how that happened. That's kind of weird. Well, anyway, bystander intervention basically is just making a choice to intervene, right? It's saying, I see something that's concerning, and I'm going to do something about it. And you're not always going to be right when you do it. I once saw a couple arguing in downtown Amherst, Kendrick Park, and I was like super worried that like there was something like not safe happening. And so I went up and did my intervention. I did the distract. I was like, I'm really lost. Do you know where Honey and Bakery is? And I was like, ah. I played this character in a play, and so I pretended I was that person. And they were actually acting a scene out in a play. And so that was kind of awkward. But at the end of the day, after like my face was not red anymore, and I was like, oh my god, I can't believe I just did that, and I was like mortified, I realized, look, what if it had been something, right? And I was actually kind of proud of myself that I had done something. And then I realized, they probably felt good about their acting, right? So that was good. So they felt really good about their acting, and then they also knew that like people were concerned. Right? And so maybe it modeled for them what they could do. Some things to keep in mind are 60% of violent crimes occur in the presence of a bystander. Bystanders are present during 27% of all acts of sexual violence. So when we think about how much we could prevent if we acted and intervened, it's extraordinarily high. And here's the statistic that you were referencing earlier. And then the presence of a bystander makes the fatality rate 44% less. So I'm going to end with, we did a vision wall at Amherst last semester where we asked students to think about what a world without sexual violence would look like. And we're reading it as a community poem tomorrow on our campus. And this is our last stanza of the poem that students, we asked them to put post-it notes of what it would mean. So these are 3 different people, but a much better world, a more respectful world, a less kind of world. And I hope that you learned something today that will help us create that. So thank you so much for having me.
And I'm going to turn it over.
Oh,
yeah.
Take your time.
I was hoping you'd run really far away.
Oh, really far away.
Lenora Riley is here. She is our interim timeline coordinator at the college, and she's going to walk us through the reporting process here so that you all have a little bit more resource. So.
So the handout that you're getting was developed before before I was doing this position, and the former English major in me has found a couple of grammatical errors in it that I simply have to live with. It's not easy. I have a little thing in my office that says, I'm quietly correcting your grammar. Silently correcting your grammar. So please know that you'll find a few these things in there. So, hi everyone. I see some familiar faces that I've seen in other contexts. I might have seen you on a playing field or in a meeting in my office for one reason or another, not Title IX related. But I've been doing Title IX work here at the college since July, and you know, it's hard work. It's hard work. And one of the things that really came to mind just listening to Amanda was the whole culture of silence around sexual violence and assault and Title IX violations, and this idea that we often know that there's a Title IX person, there's people in counseling that you can talk to, but because we don't want to invade anyone's privacy, we don't necessarily know what the process is like. And it can make it really scary to engage the process if you've been a victim. And so what I want to do is try to demystify the process a little bit so that if you or one of your friends needs some support around a violation, around violence, that you'll know what it looks like, what it can look like, what you might want it to look like. And one thing that I will say is that folks that I've talked to, students that I've talked to, other people at the college that I've talked to, are surprised to find that when they're in a difficult situation and they're not sure how they want to move forward, that they have options. And that's what my job is, to help you understand what the options that you have going forward. So for example, if you're a student who's experienced some, you know, unwanted attention, touching from someone, it could be a teammate, it could be a classmate, and you really need some help to think about how you're going to move forward to get this behavior to stop, some students will feel really fearful that if they come forward, it will get this whole ball rolling that's going to make their situation very public. It's going to create a situation where the other person is outed and ostracized from a group, or where they're ostracized because they've kind of ratted somebody for their inappropriate behavior. One of the things that we do in our office is work closely with all of the resources on campus to say, let's talk about this moment. Let's talk about what would be helpful for you. Let's talk about how we can move forward. Sometimes it means somebody's going to call somebody in and have a conversation with them. We work with a tremendous amount of confidentiality and a tremendous commitment to making sure that that the way forward for you is the right way forward for you. That said, there are certain things on campus that, if reported, they really need to kind of get ratcheted up in terms of the seriousness. So, for example, if Amanda mentioned, if someone's underage and I get a report from someone who says, I don't want to go, you know, I don't want to file a formal complaint, but it involved a 15-year-old kid, it becomes a formal complaint. So there are some things that just simply by virtue of whether or not they've broken the law, you have to move forward and report them. What I did was I put together a kind of handy-dandy handout for you beyond what you've already got that that sort of covers the basics of what I want to talk to you about. So I'm going to ask a few people to just pass things out, and I'll kind of walk you through it. I'll just keep one of these. So these will be coming around. I want to start off with a workshop, a Title IX workshop I was at Brown And they started off by showing, they've got a great little online training video that they used. And I really liked the way it starts. It talks about how every instance of sexual and gender-based harassment and violence ripples outward. Effects that begin with the people directly involved can extend to intimate social networks, professional and friendly acquaintances, and shared academic and extracurricular groups, ultimately impacting the college community as a whole. So there's a way in which, you know, as we talk about bystander awareness, responsibility, the importance of saying something if you see something, remember that if you don't, the whole community can get impacted in ways that can be really hard to repair, really hard to heal. So we want to have that kind of at the forefront. Our campus has, I think, really pretty extensive reporting mechanisms and resources. And everybody at the college falls into a kind of category. Everybody's got a designation. If you are, you'll sometimes hear the expression mandated reporter. Oftentimes you'll hear that in relation to violations that involve younger kids in schools, and teachers are mandated reporters. We use the term responsible person. And pretty much everybody at a college that has responsibility for students at the college, students who have responsibility or authority over other students, you are a responsible person. If you're a head of a residence hall, if you're a captain of a team, if a reasonable person would expect that you're someone that somebody could go to and tell something to, you are a responsible person, and you really need to think about what you're going to do with information that might be shared with you. Might be that you're going to report to Summer or to Lori, I've had this, you know, conversation I need to talk about. If somebody starts to disclose to you about a situation that, and you're, let's say, a captain of a sports team, and somebody else on your team starts to disclose something to you, you need to let them know right away, I may need to talk to somebody about this. I'm not sure where you're going in this conversation, but I may need to share this information with someone else. You're a responsible employee or a responsible person at the college. There are some people on our campus who are essentially exempt from that. People in religious and spiritual life, people in the counseling center. They by virtue of their roles on the campus, are not required to report, again, unless there's a law has been broken, in which case they too will find a way to make a report. But we've got a good set of resources and reporting systems here on campus. So you fit into one of those other designations. And I will say that if you're not a responsible person, and you're not an exempt person or a confidential person, in our community with our code of conduct, the expectation is that everybody will step up to the plate and show some responsibility in a situation where something that you just know isn't right is going on. And that's kind of unique to our campus. So how does reporting work at Montpelier? I was at a workshop in Rhode Island at Brown, and we all had to bring examples of our student handbooks. And I have to say, we got like the gold star performance at Montpelier. Your student handbook, if you're not sure about what reporting should look like, if you know somebody comes to you and you want to give them some guidance, your handbook is probably one of the clearest handbooks you could possibly have in terms of what the reporting options are and what reporting should look like. So, somebody responsible for the student handbook back here. Don't be afraid to go to that right away. And if you need clarity about that, you can call somebody like me. I'm very nice. I'm very approachable. You can give me a shout. And I say that to students all the time. I see people who have concerns that are sort of, you know, beginning level concerns that could really get out of control if they didn't address them early on. And I'm so glad when they come early on and say, I think I should say something. And I'm able to help guide them and move that process forward. And I think we have that kind of campus where you can do that. This is no place where, you know, it's no place where you have to feel like you've got to be silenced. It's really a place where people want to talk and have lots of options for you. So you can report to me, you can send me an email, you can call me up, you can make an appointment to come by my office. That's one way you can report. You can report to one of my, I love the idea, I feel like the big sheriff in town, I have deputies. Boy, that is so not the term that I would use, but I do have deputies. Summer is the deputy. She's the front-facing person in athletics. There's somebody front-facing in HR. There's somebody front-facing in the dean of faculty's office. So at every different level at the college, there's somebody who might be a person you feel more comfortable approaching, and then we can talk if they need guidance from there. The other folks you can report to, obviously, are some of the ones I said, the counseling center, the health center, Office of Religious and Spiritual Life, campus police, and residential life. You should not hesitate if you are in a situation or have a friend who's in a situation, and this is clearly the kind of thing that you think the police need to be involved, you can go to campus police. If you don't want to go to campus police, you can go to the South Hadley police. You should not hold back if you know something is really serious. And, you know, it doesn't have to be rape to be really serious, right? You can clearly go to any one of these reporting places. Res Life is another place where oftentimes people will go because they know folks in Res Life. It's a good place to start a conversation. So don't hesitate to go to the both the professionals and the student pathway through the Res Life chain. You've got a bunch of rights that you need to know about. You have the right to speak with a confidential resource. Really important. You may need to sort of take that moment to speak with a confidential resource before you want to have another conversation. Take advantage of that. That can be a really good moment to get kind of grounded, to think about what it is you want to say, how you want to say it, where you want to go. Take advantage of the confidential resources that are available on campus. You have a right to report to law enforcement, as I just mentioned, whether or not you're involved in the college's process. So don't feel like, oh, gee, I didn't go to the Title IX office, or I didn't report here. I can't go to the South Hadley police, or the Amherst police, or the wherever police. You can. You absolutely can. And you should know that you can do that. You have the right to know, understand, and submit a complaint under our harassment and grievance process. I'll talk to you a little bit more about the grievance process. You have a right to have your complaint investigated and resolved in a manner that is prompt and equitable. I think sometimes people think, oh, you know, I've got two exams next week. It's almost time to go home for break. If I get this started, it's going to go on forever. I don't have the time. I'm so stretched as it is between, you know, sports and academics. And this is just going to be, I'm going to have all these meetings and do all these conversations. We know how stressed the lives of students are. We know how busy you are. We know how hard it is to have some of these conversations. And we really do work to try to make things clear, the processes, you know, step by step, and to try to move things quickly so that you're not left kind of hanging, wondering how something's going to be resolved. Now, to be honest, sometimes things are challenging, and you know, I would love it if I could easily just have one conversation and things would become crystal clear. Sometimes I need to talk to several people to get a good sense of what's going on, but do know that we have a real commitment to respecting timelines and the process for you all. What else do I want to really hit that I think is important? You have a right to access resources off campus. And boy, do we live, that's another thing that I noticed. Providence is actually really good with its city resources for people. But we're in an area where the state funds a resource center on the UMass campus. It's not associated with the college, but it's on the campus. We have a great resource center for victims of survivors of sexual violence, and you can make a phone call, you can get a ride there, somebody will come and pick you up. You don't need to worry that it's this, how am I going to get to Amherst, I'm in this horrible place, I'm going to have to wait for the PBTA. Pick up the phone, you call. If that's hard for you to do, you can talk to me, you can talk to someone in campus police, someone in spiritual life to help you move through those processes so that you can get to the resources that you need easily and quickly. you don't have to file a complaint just because you reported something, right? Let's say that there's some kind of behavior going on that is making you uncomfortable. You want to talk about it and think about how to stop it. But you don't necessarily want to file a complaint because you're not feeling like that is the right thing to have happen for you or maybe for the perpetrator. You can come and talk to somebody about how to move forward without filing a formal complaint or even doing an informal grievance. There are ways to talk through things that can come up with good solutions. And I'll talk a little bit more about what some of those solutions and resources might be. So we have a team approach when we can talk across groups and we're not violating confidentiality. We have a team approach to how we resolve problems, and we try to come up with resources that will work for you as students. So if you're, let's say, in a situation where you've got to continue to be on a team with somebody, you've got to continue to be in a class with somebody, like Valentine Hall at Amherst College, you've got to eat in the same dining hall with other people. How can we work with you to make sure that we put some safeguards in place? It can be anything from having a no contact order, making sure that a person who has violated you, your space in whatever way, that they know they should not be contacting you, they shouldn't be talking to you and reaching out to you. You want a no contact order because a line has been crossed that you're very uncomfortable with. We can do that. We've had people on campus here and everywhere else who've been, suffered very, very serious sexual assault, and we have to intervene with faculty and say, you don't talk about specifics. You say there are circumstances in the student's life that have been extremely stressful, and we ask that you give this student all benefit of extension on work that's due in class, or the student has missed some classes, and there are good reasons. We believe there are good reasons for why this has been happening. We hope you'll be understanding. Faculty, I was on the faculty in the psych and ed department for many years before I moved into administration, and I know that as a faculty member, if I got a phone call like that, my reaction was, don't ask any questions. Believe that they wouldn't be calling you if this wasn't serious and you didn't need to really extend support and help to the student. So again, that's a place where I say, don't be afraid to use the resources. That might be just the resource you need in the moment to ground yourself, regroup, and move forward, right? Because that's what our goal is for you, that we help you through whatever stage of the healing process you might be in. We provide the resources you might need for us to help make that happen. So no contact, communication directives, academic accommodations, counseling and emotional support. Many, many times, as was pointed out, you kind of, you get that initial kick of, I'm a survivor, I can handle this, I can manage this. And then 3 months later, something happens that triggers the most intense reaction, and you can't even believe you're finally having the reaction that you thought maybe you would have had early on. Talk to somebody, get some help. If you find that's when you want to report something, come and report it then. There's not a sort of statute of limitations on when you could come and report, when we could get resources for you. Don't be afraid. It's not at all uncommon to not want to talk or get help immediately following a situation that's a violation. So give yourself some time if that's what you need, and know that we're here for you when it's time for you to talk. Our policies at the college prohibit retaliation. And I think, retaliation is a strong word, and I think it's really important to recognize that we have policies that prevent people from retaliating. It's just threatening, intimidating, harassing, and I now say in person or through social media, wow, the harassment that people can experience on social media, and it can be subtle, it can be vicious, and anything in between. we have policies that prohibit people from harassment. So let us know, let us talk through it, let us help make that behavior stop, and let us find a way to engage with somebody who might be following through on behaviors like that that are just not okay. So I guess the final piece is, and I'll walk you through a little bit of the reporting, but the question about how we adjudicate. It's hard, right, to adjudicate a situation if you've got a he said, she said, a she said, she said, a they said kind of situation. You have to listen to everything that's happened and think about what's the, you know, the appropriate response on the part of the college. We take adjudication really seriously. We're very thoughtful about it. We want the person who's been violated to feel that the college's response has been serious and real. And so, you know, it takes some time. It takes some time, but as I say, we try to do it quickly. We have certain procedures that are in place to investigate and adjudicate a complaint of harassment or discrimination, different ones in place for sexual violence. And I really like what was said about using that term sexual violence versus sexual misconduct. Misconduct sounds like you're talking in math class when you were 12, right? It's kind of a lightweight word that that kind of takes us away from the reality that we're talking about sexual violence. So anything that the college has that says sexual misconduct, and get my white out, but that shows my age. And think about using the language that really represents what it is that we're talking about. So I copied this for you because I think it's so important. The investigation and adjudication process for complaints of sexual violence are on page 70 of your current student handbook. How many people here are first-year students? Zero.
They all have Campus Clarity, so
Campus Clarity, so you don't include them. Okay. I'm going to say one thing about Campus Clarity, and I think Campus Clarity is great. That's a great orientation program. I've had students who have come to me this year and said, that's a great program. I really wish I had it in my third semester, right? Because things that you can't imagine you're going to have to deal with when you're just on campus can be very different when you're here for a few semesters and dealing with the reality of life and independence. So I'm glad you're doing this now. I'm going to end there, but just, you know, really read through this. The more you demystify the process of what it's like to file a complaint and think about what it's like to walk through it, or to even just have the conversation to think about whether or not you do it, the more prepared you will be to advocate for yourself or to advocate in support of a friend who needs that kind of support from you. So my office is on the second floor in Mary Lyon. Not enough people come up and see those lovely offices up there. So even if you just want to stop by, and you don't have a particular Title IX issue you want to talk about, you just want to talk about Title IX generally, or you've got questions, please don't hesitate to stop by. Give me a shout, make a phone call. I'm happy to set up an appointment to meet you. Okay?